I pick the side of science, and I encourage everyone to do the same.
Yes, I pick the side of science. I want that on a bumper sticker. Hi, everyone. I'm Sophia Bush. I am an actress and an activist and an advocate. This is Need to Know, a series that will help sort through your most pressing questions through conversation with reliable sources. Today's topic is COVID-19 because what else would it be? So 63% of Americans say that they are confused and overwhelmed with COVID-19 news coverage and all of the misinformation swirling around. So I decided to collect information from public health experts. This is information that we all can rely on to stay safe and healthy in the months ahead. Today, we are speaking with ER Dr. Darien Sutton to answer a very important question. How do we live our normal lives now? You know, normal to me used to mean going to meetings, having dinner with friends, seeing my family, recording podcasts in person, and working on film and TV sets. And now normal is just working from here and talking to you over a computer screen through a microphone. I want to get into some of the sort of rapid fire questions. So let's say I want to see three of my best friends whose quarantine protocols I trust. You know, we've spoken really honestly and openly about how we're staying safe, but we want to go on a socially distanced hike. Do the four of us, as none of us live together, do we need to wear masks when we meet up for that hike, even if it's outside and theoretically distanced?
Yeah, so this is a great question because this is probably the most common question that patients ask me. If I'm being blunt, if you don't live with someone and you're involving yourself in a social experience with someone else who doesn't live with you, that is sharing two different households. And so theoretically, yes, you should be wearing a mask and appropriately socially distancing. Now, I found that some of my patients and friends have found ways around this by creating these social pods. And I found in research and studies that I've done that quarantines or social pods, when done correctly, can mitigate and decrease the risk of transmission of COVID-19. But we also have to realize there's no zero risk action that you can take at all, except for locking yourself up inside of your home and not interacting with anyone. And that is not good for anyone's mental well-being. Right. So if you're going for a hike with friends, I would encourage you as much as you can, continue to wear a mask, to socially distance, to pick a path that isn't crowded, and to realize your general risk. If you're in an area that is still dealing with a high level of a pandemic in terms of numbers, then be cognizant of that. And maybe it's not the day for you to do that, or maybe you have to hold off for a week or two to help the community around you better get through this pandemic.
Where do you send people to check on how their community is doing in real time for that information?
So one of the best sites that I like to look at is called covidactnow.org. And basically it's a site that just looks at the numbers of COVID-19, specifically in all states, as well as identifying the percent positives in counties.
Okay, so super helpful information about a potential meeting up outdoors. And I really like thinking about it in terms of how we take care of our mental health and make sure we're getting the community interaction that we really need. But it does make me curious, is there a safe way to gather indoors? How do you assess that kind of risk?
When you're indoors, you have the increased risk of contamination just simply because there's likely to be ventilation that does not allow for the circulation of this virus to get away from you. But if you are participating in any event indoors, I encourage people to check, is this area crowded? Is there good ventilation? Are the windows open? And do I feel safe? Am I wearing a mask? Are other people wearing a mask? These are questions you should constantly be asking yourself.
That leads me to my next question, and I feel like I know the answer. My next question being one that was submitted when we announced we were going to do this, is it safe to eat in a restaurant? I'm guessing the answer is no.
The answer is not so much. If you choose a restaurant that is abiding by the rules of social distancing, decreased capacity, and you find that people who are providing the service are wearing their appropriate level of PPE, then I would say, sure, you can participate. But of course, there's never a zero risk restaurant experience that you can have.
I wonder how you, as a healthcare expert, how do you assess your risk in social situations? What are the thoughts or observations that you notice you have out in the world every day that the average layperson needs to start having when we walk into a grocery store or anywhere else in public?
Yeah. So for me, when I'm walking around, I'll ask myself, should I be outside? First of all, the second question is, if a place that I'm looking to go into is crowded, you know, are people physically bumping into each other? Does it seem like they're comfortably distanced? Is everyone inside of that area wearing a mask? And do I feel like the people who are working in that area are protected? These are the questions I ask myself constantly whenever I'm walking around and deciding whether or not I enter into a space, especially knowing my personal risk and exposure. It's one of the reasons why I'm so motivated to always be cognizant of that.
So other questions that came up from our audience for this, people are starting to wonder, is it safe to travel? And I get it, you know, some people have to start thinking about how to resume commutes for work. There are people who haven't seen their families in 6 months and are really itching to do so. Is it safe to travel?
If you're traveling by car, especially if you're going with someone else, you too, if you're not from the same household, are sharing a new household. Isolate before you take that trip, get tested, and know your status before you get into the car. And as you travel, make sure that you're cognizant of decreasing your risk as you travel through communities that may be high risk. That includes things like making sure you have the correct equipment to sanitize your hands, figuring out ways that you can pay without cash, cashless payments like AirPay, and also identifying places that you'll stop and decreasing those stops as much as you can. If you travel by air, we found that planes have high efficiency filters that actually have been shown to not contribute to massive increases in the transmission of this virus. But anyone who flies knows very well the experience before and after the airport is one that is in close contact and involves touching many surfaces. Number one, providing yourself with some form of sanitization. And what we know is that this virus is killed by components of 60% isopropyl alcohol and even bleach. Now, I do not condone or think you should carry around bleach in the airport. I'm not even sure if that's legal, but you can definitely carry around a baggie, a moist, damp towel that is composed of alcohol and a paper towel to help yourself clean surfaces. I don't advocate that people wear gloves every single day, every single minute, but if you want to carry disposable gloves with you for a momentary experience of maybe cleaning the seat that you sit in to wait for the plane to arrive, or maybe cleaning the packages or the bags around you and then taking off the gloves and washing your hands, these are all mechanisms that will help you decrease your risk of transmissions.
So when you think about surfaces being contaminated, that leads me to my next question, because there does seem to be a lot of confusion on this topic as well. Do we still need to be wiping down our groceries and our mail? What about that?
What we've known from viral history in general is that it's theoretically hard to get a virus from a surface. So what I would advise people is that you don't have to be aggressive about cleaning a package. If you get a delivery of food, sure, you should wear your mask when you accept that delivery to protect the other person that is delivering the food to you. And then I comfortably take out the packaging, throw that out, wash my hands, and then continue to eat my meal.
That's very good to know. So we don't have to be quite as paranoid about our mail, but we really do need to think about our social interactions. What you referred to as kind of hot zone environments, like an airport, for example. I will say, you make me feel very hopeful when you talk about the things that definitely work. The hand washing and the not touching of the face and the social distancing and the really being concerned first and foremost with your community. Checking on what level of spread your community is experiencing, basing your activity on that spread so that you're not contributing. It reminds me that if we stick in this together, we can really make a difference. And that feels like a really lovely thing to be reminded of at a time when anxiety is high. So thank you for that. I wonder, is there any other advice that you have for the months ahead? Things that you want us to know that you're already privy to?
So now as we move into the next coming months of September, especially in November, I think we have to be cognizant that there will be announcements that will likely distract from the primary issues that are at play here. And I hope people understand there are people who are not being able to be tested. We have disproportionate effects of this virus on communities. And we're trying to use research that does not illustrate that disproportionate effect or that quantity of people on these communities. And I think it's really, really important to realize back to basics is so valuable and important.
Thank you. I can't tell you how helpful I think this is going to be for so many people.
Thank you so much.